So, welcome everyone today from a different location. What, because we have street construction going on. What else can you wish for? And but I thought this topic is so important that I don't want to cancel the stream, but instead move to my daughter's room. So if there are any incursions or distractions, let's see what's happening. Cool, we have 2 minutes to go. I just wanted to pull up one more thing. Oh, it's okay. So, if you want to play along, you can basically go to sandbox.neofidio.com and then use use case FinCEN, and then you get a database that has the data already in it. I think in my case I already have it running. No, I don't have it running. So it basically offers you to launch this data set. I think it should also be listed in the projects view. So we just added it yesterday. Oh, here it is. So there's FinCEN investigation. And so you can find this here in the bottom left corner as well. Which should actually move up in the top left corner, top right corner. Right, so if you want to play along, please log into Neo4j Sandbox and start a sandbox, and then you can continue or join us in exploring that. Hey Jonathan, hey Bernhard. I speak German, yes, but the audience is English, so I'll speak English, Bernhard. But if you want to chat in German, you can also chat in German later. Herzlich willkommen. Okay, it's top of the hour. Church bells ringing outside, so we can get started. Welcome everyone. Please let me know where you're watching from, so that I see kind of how far we reach with our stream. I'm really excited because it's kind of this time of the year, like a few years ago when the ICIJ launched the Panama Papers investigation, which was pretty big news. I think the news today will be probably a little bit drowned by COVID and US elections and Brexit in the UK and refugee crisis and climate crisis. Tomorrow is also global climate protest. So I don't think it will see as much light of the day as it should, because what's actually interesting, this data this time is covering not just $1.2 billion like the Panama Papers did, but up to $2 trillion of money flows. So, what is this about? On Sunday, the ICIJ launched an investigation called the FinCEN Files, where FinCEN stands for an US Treasury institution, which is the Financial Crime Enforcement Network, I think. Financial Crimes Enforcement Network, FinCEN. And there were reports leaked. Actually, that was these were already leaked earlier by Natalie Mayflower-South Edwards, and she was actually indicted for that as well. And those files were leaked to the ICIJ, so they have now 2,100 files with activity reports where lots of money flew between or moved between large banks. The ICIJ has very detailed data on that. The published data is only aggregated, so there's no information about the individual account holders and account owners in the published data. But what's interesting is that all the major large banks and small banks are involved into that, and you see where how the money flows from which country to which country, from which bank to which bank. And these reports are not just regular transactions, but these are suspicious transactions, right? So transactions that suspicious transactions that have been flagged by the banking officers at the banks and reported to the FinCEN. So this is actually or a suspicious data from the get-go, and it's really interesting to see really interesting to see the impact of that. So if you want to watch, there's also a video from the ICIJ, and they also extracted some stories from that. It goes basically from Nigeria, Russia, Angola. So you might have heard of Isabel dos Santos recently from the OCCRP investigations. Ukraine, Paul Manafort is in here as well. Venezuela, and so on, right? So there's a lot of people involved that are actually known for their misconduct as such, right? And what the ICIJ did, they again gathered, I think, 400 reporters to analyze this data. It took them probably again like close to a year to analyze this data in detail, because usually they use these leaked data files only as starting points for their investigations, so kind of as suspicions or indications, and then they dive deeper and use their other sources, local information, other files that they have, or like local criminal authorities and so on, to verify and validate records like this. So, and the ICIJ published as part of this a large set of documents and articles, and all their media partners also published a large set of documents. They used their data platform DataShare to analyze the data. They used it for entity extraction and search, but then they also used to kind of connect the dots, like they did before in the Panama Papers and Paradise Papers and offshore leaks in general. They again used Neo4j and Linkurious. So here they talk a little bit about DataShare, and they also used Neo4j and Linkurious to analyze the connections between all these banks as such. And on Sunday, when they published it, there was actually no data available yet. So I basically had to scrape it from the JavaScript application that I use here for the visualization. And then later in the evening, they actually published two CSV files with the data that I'll show you in a second. Okay, and so you can explore the data with this JavaScript application, kind of seeing where how money flows from A to B. So you can say, okay, I want to see how much money went from Angola and to Angola, and then you can see basically who filed these reports, and so on. So that's kind of an interactive investigation. You see how much money has been flowing here, and so on. So that's a really nice JavaScript application that does it on the fly. Hello to Karlsruhe. Lots of Germans here today. So this is kind of what you can get out of the box from them. And as I said, on the data side, you can download the zip file, and in the zip file there are two CSV files that we can import into Neo4j. So which I did on Sunday night. So I spent till until I think 1 in the morning or something like that, getting this data imported and cleaned up, and started to pull this all together. So if you want to see kind of the fruits of my work, you can go to GitHub and see in my repository the import files, Neo4j dump files, bunch of images, Cypher scripts for importing the JSON, the original JSON. And then I created the second file for importing the CSV as well. So we'll do this in a second, so you see what it looks like. I try to make it as straightforward as possible, but because a lot of people don't. Hello, Salim. Bernard, yeah, we can talk quickly. I don't have too much time, but we can talk in German afterwards as well. So I put all this on GitHub so you can follow along. And but we also, for those people that are not familiar with Neo4j and that don't know anything about the details on how to run Cypher statements and stuff like that, we also prepared a sandbox and a demo database, so which I'll show you as well. And then we look into some queries and some visualizations and stuff like that. And if you have suggestions or questions, we can look into these as well. So hope that sounds good for you and we can get started. So basically what you can do is you can download the files, basically, and get the zip file, and then in the zip file you have the CSV files. So the CSV files look like this. Let me show you. So downloads FinCEN and it modified. So there's one called download bank connections. And the other one is called download, what's the other one? Download transactions map. So download bank connections is basically the filings. So you see the ICIJ SAR ID, that's the suspicious something report, activity report, suspicious activity report ID, who filed this report, which other entity is involved with this, and which countries are they related to, right? So which countries is this related to? And in the other file for the filing is also, when did the filer again, from when to when was this filed? Most in most cases, it's the same date. Where did the money flow from? So that doesn't have to be the filer. It could be something that a third party observed in transfer and they filed it and someone else was the originator. So we get the originator's name and ID and the country as well. And then also where did the money go to, which is the beneficiary here in this case, right? So we get the beneficiary's information. We see the monetary amount and the number of transactions. And you already see, so this is kind of in dollars as far as I know. So we should be able to just sort it by this. Amount transactions, no, we want to, yeah, amount transactions descending. And so if you look at the numbers, they are pretty gigantic numbers. So that's here like $2 billion or something like that, that went from one bank to another, right? Amsterdam Trade Bank to Rosbank in Russia, right? So, and the other filings have also pretty large numbers, like $1 billion, $800 million, $500 million, and so on. So it's gigantic volume of money that was reported here, right? And I think that's only the tip of the iceberg, right? So that's definitely really interesting to see what else is there. Bernard, we're using OBS for streaming and Restream.io for splitting it on YouTube and Twitch as such. But otherwise, just OBS with default settings. Okay, so we have this data. And now we can actually look at how would we import this data into Neo4j. So what we can do is I can go back to the GitHub repository and you see that I have here the Cypher script that loads the data. Basically, I start by creating a bunch of indexes and constraints. So we want to have unique countries, unique entities, and unique filings, where filings are these suspicious activity reports. And then we, which have their own IDs, and then we add a bunch of indexes for quicker search, like entity name, filing begin and end, amount, and so on. And then we start loading the data. So, and to do this, I can do actually any kind of data source. So let me start with Neo4j sandbox. So what we can actually do is we can take a blank sandbox and use that one. I can, let me just quickly terminate this one and create a new blank sandbox. So this is an empty Neo4j database. So if you want to, you can also use Neo4j desktop if you have Neo4j desktop downloaded and add a new database there. So if I say add local database, I can say this is my FinCEN Twitch database. Give it a password. Create a database. I can do it on both at the same time, so you can see how it works. And so while we're creating the database in desktop, we have to plan sandbox here in Neo4j browser, in our browser. Open this one, and this gives us an empty database. And what we have to do now is actually just copy and paste the script, because I also put the CSV files on GitHub, so I can just refer to the file on GitHub to import the data, so I don't have to do it basically manually. Don't have to download the data and put it in the right directory and so on. So, okay, let's start by basically creating the indexes. And then I'll walk you through the actual import as such. So I just copy this and paste it in here in my sandbox. So this creates the indexes one after the other. And while it's doing this, we can look at the actual import statements. So this is a very simple import statement here. This just loads. Come on. What is happening here? Proper demo effect. Why is it not? Probably the container just had to warm up. So, okay, this is our really simple import statement. This uses download transactions map.csv as source. And if you just get this data and show it, then we see each of these lines of the CSV is turned into a dictionary or map with all the data in the CSV that I showed you before, right? Like the ID, the originator, the filer, the amount, and all the other things as well, right? So here's the number of transactions, and there's amount somewhere, and so on, right? So basically, what I do is I just take this data, create a filing node based on the ID, and then set all these properties on the data. So just to get it in, right? Jonathan, yeah, you can run the script all in one go. You can run it either by pasting it into Neo4j browser or by running Cypher shell with the -f flag with a file as well. So you can run it in all in one go. So if I run this, it will create the filings. And then I have 4,500 filings created. And let's see. I'm not sure what's happening today here. It's a proper demo thing. So I need to see what happened here. So okay, to not waste too much time with this, I'll just continue in desktop. I just have to install the GDS plugin and APOC as a plugin, because I want to show some data science stuff later, and APOC for the time conversion things. So APOC is just a utility library that is super helpful. Okay, let's start a database. So I don't know what's oh, I know what's wrong. My Brave browser is blocking a ton of JavaScript here, and that's why I guess it's not working correctly. So let's reload this, and I think that should be helping. Okay. I hope you can see everything fine. OBS just told me that it's overloaded a little bit with encoding. On this machine, which is really weird because it should not be overloaded on this machine because it's a pretty fast computer. But let me know if it's okay for you. Okay, so we imported the data, and let's try this again. So we click on the entities, and now the entity should be there. Something is not working here. Okay. Okay, I guess I'll skip the sandbox then and switch to desktop. So basically what you can do now is either, Jonathan, as I said, you can just use the terminal and with Cypher shell and the dash command, dash F command, you can just run the import like this. So if I put this in, then it says loading the indexes and loading the data, basically. And then it's done, basically. So, and if I, let me just quickly clean out this again and so that I can show it to you in the UI. So that's kind of how you would do it as a file, as a single file import. So if you go back to our database, we can just open Neo4j browser either from the sidebar here or by clicking on this open button. And in Neo4j browser, we can now basically load the script from here. So we have the indexes and our filings. And just paste this in here. And come on. Oh, constraints already. Oh, yeah, the constraints already exist. So we don't need all the stuff. We just need the data. Because I only cleaned out the data. Okay. Let's see if it works locally. What? Oh, sorry. I was clicking on entity, but I meant to click on filing because the entity is only there because the index is there. Okay, so it was problem was in front of the keyboard or in front of the screen. So if you look at the filings, so the filings are now here, and I see all the data on the filing as well. So if I see all these nodes, and if I click on one of these nodes, I can also open here the little attribute view, and you see kind of what's there for each of the filings. Okay, that's level start step one. The second step is basically a little bit more involved, but I'll talk through this. So what we do, we load the second CSV file, which has one row that concerns one aspect of a filing, but the same filing is mentioned multiple times in the in the CSV. So that's why we find this filing, which is mentioned in this line. Oh, actually, let's look at the data first. Return value limit 10. So you should see that here's the ICIJ SAR ID. And this SAR ID can be repeated. So here you see 3181, and that's mentioned, for instance, here on two different rows or three different rows, right? So four, five. So there are more banks that are involved into this filing, and so they are added as additional entities to this filing in the, with the second file, right? So and what we do is basically we find the filing. Then let's see. So we find the filing, then we find the file layer, which basically is mentioned in the file. And then when the file didn't exist yet, we create the set the name as well. And we create a location from the geo information. So there's a latitude and longitude in the file. So we create just a point, a geo point for Neo4j, and set this as the location. And then we do the same for the entity B, which is kind of the other thing in the file. We create another entity, which is the bank, and then we can set the location again. And we also set the country code. And for the country, we also create a node. So we have also our countries as well. And then we say, okay, the filer filed this filing. The filing concerns this other entity because it's just called entity B. So it's kind of just an they are mentioned, but it doesn't say what it is about, why they are mentioned there. And then we connect the other entity to its country, right? So the bank to its country. And if you run this, then it should create also a bunch of relationships. So we should now see something like filed relationships here. And if I click on the filed relationship, then I see, for instance, this bank, Bank of New York, filed all these reports, right? Okay, so let me do the same in the sandbox. So I should have clicked on filing, not on entity, right? So then I see my filings. So I can just copy this full script over here into my sandbox. So just that you see that it doesn't matter if I run it on Neo4j Sandbox or in Aura, Neo4j Aura or in local desktop. So it's all the same. So Sandbox and Aura come with APOC included already, so you can use that out of the box there. Okay, and the next step is basically, remember we created this really huge filing data point with all the details, and actually we just pulled it in. And this is the last step where we take the data on the filing and turn it into some proper data that we can use. So let's look at this a little bit. We find each filing. We turn, because it's coming from a CSV, all the fields are strings originally. So we want to change this. So we turn the number of transactions into an integer. We turn the amount into an float. We turn the end date and the begin date into an proper date type, because currently, if you look at the filings, the end and start and end dates are just something like September 25th, 2015, so which is not really a good format. So it's not ISO format and nothing else. So we'll turn this into a proper datetime. And then we use the other information, the beneficiary, so who received the money, is another entity that we create. So you see we're creating a lot of entities as part of this. We create the beneficiaries, set the names, and the location, like we did before. We create a country for the beneficiary, and connect the beneficiary to the country, and connect the filing to the beneficiary. Then we connect the filing to the filer, just in case the other data file didn't have the information. And as the last step, we also create the same for the originator, so the entity that the money came from. Right. So if I run this now, it converts all the filings. Oops. Oh, that's interesting. So that's a newer APOC version that needs this. Okay, interesting. So I have to do it differently in here. So that's actually good exercise. So we can use instead APOC date pass. And we say we want to have milliseconds, and we just say we get an date time from this and say epoch seconds, and this is our date format. So we can also paste it to an integer, a long value here, and then treat this as in seconds input. And then we get date from this. So date from date time from epoch date pass and this. So and we do the same for the begin date as well. Good that we tried it out. So let's see if this works. Probably miscounted parentheses. Okay, it's 1, 2. Oh no, I forgot to close the map here. Cannot construct this for no value. That's not so nice. So we just turn this into a zero instead of a null. Now it should work. Yeah. So now we took the filing and turned it into all these relationships. So when I now get a filing, each of these filings should now have many more relationships. So if I expand the filing, it has, let's see, it has banks that are concerned by this filing, originators, and there should be also a filer, and so on, right? So these filings now have many more connections as such, right? And the purple ones are the banks, and the orange ones are the filings here in this case. Okay, now we have our data in the graph. We do the same for the local installation, just to be on par. But for the local installation, because there I have a newer APOC version, I can just take the script as such. You see that I created the CSV script locally and not on the sandbox. So now we have the data in the graph, and now we can start to explore it. So, by the way, if you haven't seen it, we also yesterday published a blog post about this, looking at the data, giving some details and background, and also kind of explaining how we got the data in, and so on, right? I have also set up demo server with the data because we didn't have the sandbox yesterday, you can now also just use the sandbox for that. So I should probably adjust this. So two things that we can do is we can explore it visually with Bloom, which is actually quite cool. So let me do this. I can just in my local desktop, but also on sandbox, I can just start Neo4j Bloom. Let me go to desktop. So I just start Bloom. Or you can also open it from the sidebar here. And in Bloom, let me just disable developer mode so it's not taking up any space. I was just checking something yesterday. Okay. So I could select which database I want to use, as there's only one database in the DBMS. I use that one. I create a perspective. Hey, Ardan, good to see you. I create a perspective, and then I can say use this perspective. And perspective is more like a data model for this. So I can now use this to interact with the data. But what I can also do is I can kind of style it up a little bit. So I can say, okay, my countries have an location sign, my entities have a bank icon, and my filings get a dollar. Is there a dollar sign somewhere? Here's a dollar sign. Right. So for instance, when I now say entity Deutsche Bank, I can hopefully entity name Deutsche Bank, I can find all Deutsche Banks. So all the local subsidiaries. So if you want to, you can also look in the card here, and you see that's all the different jurisdictions, basically. It's also really interesting that they have completely different IDs. That's really interesting. Anyway. So that's one thing that we can do, kind of just search for an entity here. The other thing that's more interesting is, of course, to look at the relationships. Right, so I just clear the scene. And I can, for instance, say, I want to see all filings that have an entity that is in a country named Russia, right? Or actually not an entity, but all filings that benefits an entity. Right, so there's a filing, which has a benefits relationship, goes to an entity, which is a bank, and then that has a country named Russia. Right, so that's all the entities, all the filings that go into Russia. Right, so the yellow one is the country, the purple ones are the banks, and the orange ones again are the filings. And what we can do now as well, to make this a little bit more interesting in Bloom, is we can say we want to do some rule-based styling and add a rule-based styling, for instance, for the for why doesn't it show me? That's weird. Oh, filing, sorry. Not the entity, but the filing. For the filing, I want to add a rule-based styling based on the amount, which is a number. And I want to say this is a range, and I want to change the size by this. And my min size, it's say $100,000. And my max size is, let's add three digits. And I would say the min size is 0.5, and the max size is 2x of size. And if I apply this, you should see that the sizes of these filings get different, right? So depending how big the filing is, how much money is in there, the bigger is the filing here. And what we can also do is here in the visualization and the caption, we can switch from the ICIJ ID to the amount as a caption, so that we, when we zoom into this, we actually also see how many dollars were attached to these filings as well, right? So you see also the smaller the number, the smaller the visualization as well, right? Okay, so that's something that we can do in Bloom. We can also explore other things. So for instance, I could say I want to have all filings where basically I have an entity name like Ross Bank, and that has a filing, and I want to say originator, and then I say let's say entity, what do you want to use name, what was the one bank, let's say Deutsche Bank or something like that, right? So we see kind of, we can say, okay, in filing where the beneficiary fits. So, and if I do something like this, then I can also explore this, right? So I can say, okay, how many filings are in my data were originating from the Deutsche Bank, it went to Ross Bank, right? So, so this is kind of like the interactive stuff. What I can also do in Bloom is I can put at my custom search phrases, which is basically cipher statements that then can return data for an investigator or something like that, where I just pass parameters to the search phrase and then it shows me the stuff, which you can actually try in a second. So the other thing that's quite nice is that you can also query the data with Cypher, of course, right? So here's one query that says, find me the 10 largest filings and which entities have been involved with these 10 largest filings, right? So I can just copy and paste this into my Neo4j browser, either here or in Sandbox, and then run this. So this is kind of just gets the filing, orders them by amount, and gives me the entities that are somehow related to it. So it could be like the filer, the originator, and so on. Sergio, in Neo4j browser, we can export it just by using this drop-down icon here. We can export it as PNG and SVG. And I think in Bloom got also the feature of exporting. I just have to think about, was this here? Oh no, export as CSV. So you need to probably take a screenshot otherwise with your system. But I think exporting as images is also on the roadmap for the newer versions of Bloom. But I'll take this also as feedback. It definitely makes sense to export this as SVG or PNG, right? So because that would be quite useful. Good point. But in Infrared browser, we can do this. So these are like our biggest filings and kind of who's been involved with these filings, right? So you see also sometimes the beneficiary is also mentioned in the as an NTTB in the details as well. So you have concerns and benefits basically as well. So that's one query that we can run. And then the other query that I had here in the blog post was give me also the total. So I find an entity like a bank, and for this entity, I sum up all the amounts of all the filings basically that this entity was involved in. And then we collect the countries basically for these entities, and we get the entities that have been most frequently involved in some way or form with a filing, right? So, I mean that's a little bit. We should probably put in something like originator or beneficiary, right? So because otherwise it's the filer might not be, they just raise the concern as such, right? So then we find this pattern, we sum up all the filing amounts, and then get the top 10 from this list, and then find for each of these entities also the country, and collect all the countries for these entity, because sometimes there's multiple countries mentioned for a entity like Deutsche Bank. You see here all these countries, right? So when you see that Rosbank is the biggest involved, Amsterdam Trade Bank is also because it's the originator for many of these, and then you see kind of these things. So as an investigator, I could kind of look into this as well, right? And did I have a third query? No. So we can also do other data visualizations like geo visualization. So this one is actually quite nice. So Nearmap is also a desktop application for Neo4j desktop. So I can just install it here as a graph app. It has Nearmap here somewhere. I have too many graph apps, I guess. So because I don't want to search, I just start it as. Oh, I didn't have it installed. So I can show you how to install a graph app. So there's a graph apps, the graph apps gallery. And I should be able to just click on. Oh, because I'm on Linux, it's not that trivial. So I need to copy and paste this link into Neo4j desktop. On Windows and OS X, it works automatically, but on Linux, the deep link does not work out of the box. But I can install it from here, and then it says, "Do you want to install this?" Yes, I want to install this. And then I get Neomap somewhere installed. Here's Neomap. You can open it, and that's a geospatial application. And what I can do is I can say I want to have a new layer that is like entities, and I can say I want to have a Neo4j built-in point, and I have my entity and the shouldn't be location, ID, name. Didn't I set location on the entity as well? That's weird. Let me see. So I have entity, and on each entity, oh, I thought that I had a location for the entity. Did I not set this? Oh, I remember. I think the. Was it in the. I remember in the CSV there is no latitude and longitude. It's only in the JSON. And because you imported the CSV in this one, I don't have latitude and longitude. But it's not a problem because I have another database, an older database that I worked on yesterday, that that we can just use instead. So I just use this one here instead, which has actually the JSON import. So the JSON import, just to quickly show you the JSON is, where is it here? So the JSON import uses kind of this script JSON that I got from their web app, which is called sardata.json. And if you look at the data here, you see that you have actually oh no, it's in SAR details, sorry. And SAR details, you're wrong. Right, so because that was missing in the CSV. Let's just look at our one. Come on. I mean, can probably just show it to you on locally. So where's my details? So details.json. So here you see that you have latitude and longitude for each entity for the filer, for the originator, and for the other entity as well, right? So in these JSON files, we have geodata. So as I now started my other database here, I should be able, hopefully, if I reload new map, to say this is my entities layer. And I want to look at entity. I have point, Neo4j point, and I have my location property and the name as the. So I could just render them all as dots basically on a map, right? So if you click on these, then you get like an detail of the fully different banks. Or we can also render it as a heap map. Can probably put in a limit of 1,000 or so. And then we can render these entities as a heat map and see kind of in which areas are most entities located, right? So that's kind of some geo things that we can do as well. And the last thing that I want to show you is some data science, graph data science, because yeah, Sergio, for Bloom, yeah, it would be nice to have a plugin system, but screenshots might be it right now. So data science is what's really interesting, because we have this graph data science library for Neo4j that can run a lot of graph algorithms on really large data sets. So this is actually a tiny data set, right, if you look at it. It's meant to be run on data sets that are like millions or billions of nodes and relationships. The graph data science library can run even on these large data sets really quickly. What we want to do is the following. We want to basically create a projected graph between entity and entity. So basically the originator and the beneficiary of a filing. So kind of the money flow from one entity to another entity. And sum up all the filings between those two entities. So not do one per filing, but kind of pull them all together into one relationship. So we basically take the from and to entities and put them together here. I just saw that someone in the formatting of the WordPress blog post messed up the formatting, so I have to fix this later. So that means if we go to our data here. By the way, if you want to start stuff with this kind of quick start, then you just add a click on this search thing here, magnifying glass, or you press Command K or Control K. I like to use this much more. So we go back to browser, and basically what we now can say is we find our source and target entities, the originator and the beneficiary, and the filing in between. We sum up all the amounts of the filings and create a new relationship between the source and the target, and set the total as a property on the relationship, right? So this kind of money flow graph. So if I run this, should be pretty quick. Yep. And now I have these transferred relationships here, which are actually pretty cool because they show us who sent how much money to whom. And if we click on the transferred relationship here, we can actually set the amount as the visualization. So we see also how much money flew between or moved between these entities as well, right? So we can now do this also in Bloom. Of course, it's a new database. I need to create a new perspective, but that's not a problem. And now I can say entity transferred entity. So that's kind of my money flow graph. And if I pull this for the whole data set, let's see, we should see kind of clusters of money flows, right? So there are also like pairs where money just went between these two banks, but you also have these kind of small clusters here where, you know, does it show the direction? So for instance, here you have some banks that are sources of money and then some banks that are more like sinks of money, where the money went into these sinks as such, right? And so we as humans can spot these kind of clusters visually in such a graph visualization, right? But how can we make it so that these classes are also detected by an algorithm, right? So because imagine this was not 1,000 banks, but it was 100,000 or 1,000,000 or 1,000,000,000 transactions, right? So then it would be really interesting to see how we can do this with an algorithm. And this is where the Graph Data Science Library comes into play. And we can run something that we call the Graph Data Science Playground, which is, which one is the right one? Doesn't matter, I guess. Which is basically an UI for the Graph Data Science Library, which makes it easier to get started with it. Because the syntax is quite comprehensive and for running these algorithms, because there's many options that you can choose. And so this is basically an UI that one of my colleagues, Mark Needham, built to make this easier to use. So we can select different databases. So I have my Neo4j default database in this case, with the filings, the entities, and all our relationships. So that's really nice that we can see this. And then we want to do this kind of community detection clustering. So we could say we want to have the Louvain algorithm choose entity as a label. We say we want to use the transferred relationship type in the natural direction. We want to use amount as the weight property. We don't want to seed this. We want to store the results. We want to store the results as a cluster ID. And let's say we want to show 100 results and show only top 5 nodes of each community. So if you run this algorithm, it's really quick. And then it basically computes the clustering for each of these, for each detected cluster, right? So you see these community IDs don't have a meaning, they're just an ID, but you see how big are these clusters, and here are some example banks from these clusters, right? And then if you look at the visualization, we can basically say we can see the different colors indicate the different clusters. So you see if they are like smaller clusters, they are the same color, but you can see that the identified same colored ones are the same cluster as such, right? You have some that have that are currently a different color, but that's because I think it does not return all nodes. What we can do here is I can increase this to, I don't know, 2,000 banks or something like that. Then the visualization, the algorithm runs the same, It's just how much data is returned to the table and to the visualization, right? So I think the visualization will take more time now to render. But what we can also do, we can now use this cluster ID in Neo4j Bloom to say we want to have actually an color-based, rule-based styling based on the cluster here. And we have a range, I think, and we want to do color, and the min point is 0, and the max point is, I don't know, 2000 or something like that. And then we can choose two colors, so a green from green to a red or so, some kind of red. And hopefully, if I now click apply, you see that the different clusters get different colors here as well, right? So you have like the different red styles, greenish style here. So you can at least see some of this being visualized, right? I hope that in the future Bloom will also get proper kind of discriminate styling where you just say give each kind of value a different color, and that makes it easier. Oops, I removed it. Anyway, so the other thing that I wanted to show you, because you're almost out of time, is PageRank. Because you could treat this money flow almost like an transitive operation. So you could say, okay, money flows from one. Let's see. Here we have some more clusters. Now you see also that these colors also come in groups, right? So the yellow ones are over here, these are here, and so on. So the kind of colors are also applied in groups. I think in the middle there's a lot of back and forth, so it's not so easy to kind of discern the clusters in general. The other thing is PageRank or centralities, which is basically a transitive measure. So if someone points A points to B and B points to C, then B benefits from A pointing to B, right? Jonathan, the topic is the ICIJ FinCEN files. If you want to read more about this, you can go to Neo4j.com blog, and we have a blog post about this in more detail, or you watch the recording after because you're almost done. Okay, for PageRank, so what we want to do, if we want to use the same relationship, the transferred relationship, natural direction, weight properties, again, amount. We otherwise go with the defaults. We want to store the result as PageRank, and we probably, so that the visualization doesn't take too long, we take this here, and now we see, okay, Ross Bank and Novik Bank have really high PageRank, so they have been recipients by a lot of money. And if you look at the visualization, it should also show. We can take cluster as the color, so we also see the different sizes here, right? So you have here, you have Ross Bank, and here's the DSB Bank, and somewhere is the this one here is probably the, or this is Credit Suisse, and somewhere else is the other one. So, and these sizes can also be visualized in Bloom as well, right? And there's lots of other algorithms that you can run, for instance, which banks connect different clusters, so that would be between the centrality, and so on. So there's a lot of other things that are also possible. If you have any questions of what you want to look at, I'm happy to do in the last few minutes to do more of this. The other thing that I just wanted to show you is if you're really new to this and just want to get started, then you can really say, I want to launch this whole thing as a sandbox. You click on this button here, say launch project, and it gives you an instance with all the data already loaded, with all the data already loaded, and an interactive guide or slideshow to go through this as well. So let's see. Yeah. And you can order the things in the sandbox that I did here also with Bloom and also with GDS. There's something new that I can show you which is not been released, but I give you a sneak preview. If you do neuler.graphapp.io, you get the web version of this, so you can basically use the connection details from your sandbox as well to run against this. That works as well. So now we have the ICIJ file files data sandbox here, and if you launch Neo4j browser, we can then see that the data has already been loaded. There's also some more stuff. So I started to work on a Jupyter notebook that was kind of a copy of the Panama Papers one, and I started to play around here. But unfortunately, the library that we used you to do these really nice code diagrams is broken now. So they removed this feature. So we need to change this to another feature, and so we need to fix this. That's why I haven't included this. And my colleague Adam created a web app that does a map visualization like this one here. Where's it? Like this one, which kind of renders the beneficiaries of money flows in a really nice map view as such as well. So if you want to see a JavaScript application that does this with, I think, Leaflet, you can do this really quickly as well. Okay, and so where's the sandbox? Has it started? Here. And so this comes with an interactive browser guide that I put together really quick, which has basically the similar things. So the Bloom discussion, data model, some data exploration, money flow, and then graph data science, basically. So the things that we did today as well. So if you want to follow along, feel free to go to sandbox and launch this. And cool. Sounds good. Any other questions, then please let me know. Otherwise, you can ping me later as well. Cool. Feel free to take the data, the repository. If you have any pull requests, feel free to send pull requests there to add or update things as well. And there, as I said before, there's a ton of content from the ICIJ about these investigations. Because I was so busy with the data, I actually was not able to read all of that and watch all of that. But there's a lot, like also on from the BBC, Süddeutsche Zeitung, and from a lot of other publications and partners. So they have a lot of partners for this investigation as well. And I think there will be much more coming out as time goes by, basically. Cool. Thanks a lot. And I hope you enjoyed this. And I'll make the recording available as well. And let me know if you have any more questions, either on Twitter or drop me a GitHub issue or a message on Slack or on the community site. Salim, it depends on what you mean. So the geomap visualization, you have to click update map to update the data. And for the other ones, it depends really what you're doing. I think most of the UIs are not automatically updating, because that would be quite confusing when new data comes in that it updates all the time. But it really depends on how your app is built, if it automatically updates or not. It would need to rerun queries and add it to the existing data as such. So right now, almost all apps only show the data that you saw the first time. And if you want to refresh it, then there's a rerun button, for instance, here. I can do a rerun button, and then it basically reruns the operation as such. The data update. Yeah, they haven't updated the data so much. What you can do, this import file, you can just rerun it time and again, and it will take the files and import them. Actually, that's a good point. There's a little bit of a small problem with the data update. Where's this here? Because they put it onto their WordPress, if I'm not mistaken. Let me see. Copy link. Yeah. Okay, that's on WordPress 2020.09, and so this if it goes to October, it probably changes to 0.10. And what we could do is so Epoch has a way of doing. Actually, let me show you. So I can do Epoch load CSV. So Neo4j's own CSV doesn't allow this, but Epoch's load CSV can. Can use an exclamation mark and the file name. I just need to quickly find the file name. So the file name is download bank connections.csv. So yield yield map return map limit 10. Yep, so we could actually get it directly from them for the import. Bernhard, my name is Michael Hunger or Michael Hunger, and you find me if you Google Michael Hunger, then you find me everywhere. So, and you can ping me, for instance, if you go to neo4j.com Slack, we have a user Slack where you can just ping me as well. Or on community.neo4j.com. Or you can also drop me an email to michael@neo4j.com. Okay, Salim, so we could actually use the original source file for the import, so we don't actually have to download it and use that for the import. So we would at least get the latest from them when they change the files as such. So that's actually a good idea. So perhaps I'll find time to change this as well. And I should change the epoch function to be backwards compatible as well. Cool. Thanks a lot for your time. This was really nice. And I hope you have a good day and talk soon. And see you next week, I guess. Bye bye.